don't know, it's a fun world. It's so much different than anything that I was ever used to. I was in the athletic side of things, and until I graduated from high school, I hadn't really delved into the arts at all. And then after I graduated, before my freshman year at college, I started getting into theater and really enjoyed that world and just kind of, you know, as you set down one path, you just explore and find what you love about it. And forensics was one of those things that was further down the path, but I've really enjoyed it. All the experts. I would say that as far as what I do as a coach, I probably coach more in the debate realm. Just because with my interp kids, it's very much up to what they can do with something, how they will act and how they will respond to a certain piece is what's going to dictate how it's going to go. To get kids past that point, to get them to realize that it's more than just having a piece and saying some words. It's having it and really doing that interpretation piece of it. What the meaning is behind it, trying to gather the essence of the piece and present that and do it justice. And that's the hardest thing, I think, is getting the new kids acquainted with that process. Aside from that, it's pretty easy. I mean, you go and you say, I'd like you to change this, I'd like you to change that, and then they go and they do it. We usually have somewhere between 12 and 15 schools, which is about as much as our school can contain.
Mm-hmm.
We have, I think, 30 rooms total, and we break it into two waves. So you'll have four events running at once, and then once that wave is done, the other four events will run then. And so usually you have four or five sections of one event, where you might have seven sections of another event. So you have all of your rooms full all the time. So that's about as many as we can fit. The most difficult thing is organizing judges, because ours is all completely volunteer-based. We don't really have a crew of judges like a lot of the schools up in Springs or Pueblo do. You know, they have meets up there every weekend or every other weekend where these judges will go, and they get paid to judge up there. And so saying, okay, on a Saturday I can go make, you know, 30, 40 bucks just for judging some forensics.
Mm-hmm.
It's okay. We do it once a year, and the judges that we have are usually the same judges that we've had the year before, but sometimes those judges move away, or they were parents of kids who were competing, and then they say, okay, I'm going to go do other things now. And so just trying to replenish that pool of judges is kind of always my challenge. And then just organizing the other stuff,
mm-hmm.
you know, food, what time do we need to get the building open? How do I get all the lights to turn on in the building? If I'm locked out of a room, how do I get in there? Setting up where the judges should go, where everything else should go, the food and for the judges and for the competitors and things like that. So that's really the most difficult part of the season for me is getting that tournament set up. The reason that we have only one, because we've had a couple in the past.
Mm-hmm.
We did this one, and then we did one that I called the Junction Jubilee, which was a half-day meet where we ran all eight events at the same time, and we just ran three rounds, and it was done by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, which was one of the best ideas I've ever had. But the tough thing with that is the judge thing, to get the same judges to come back for another one. They've seen all the pieces already anyway, and it's really tough to kind of keep it fresh that way. So we go with the one, because there's other meets that we can go to, and the reason we did that one in the past was because in February, it was, I think, the 2nd of February, they had a meet, and then there was nothing up until we had state quals, which was like the 28th, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was kind of an empty month where kids weren't really able to prepare. So we ran that meet as a kind of a last-minute vamp up to what we were going to be seeing at state quals. That's a tough question. Because you say, forensics. What is forensics?
Right.
Oh, it's speech and debate. What does that mean? Well, we do these different events. We have interp events where you perform. You get a piece of literature or a play that's pre-written, and you memorize and perform that. Or you can do speeches. You have extemporaneous speaking. You have original oratory. And then you have debates as well, Lincoln Douglas or public forum debates. And they say, what are all of those things?
Yeah.
And so then you kind of have to say, what are you interested in? Do you want to debate, do you think? Would you be the one that would have a story to tell of your own? Or do you want to be somebody that's up there doing some kind of a performance? And if they say, I don't know, I don't know any of those things. Sometimes, you know, if I'm persistent enough, I can talk them into it and maybe find a way to get them into one of those, some way or another. But sometimes I just have to kind of look and say, you know, if that's not the kind of stuff that interests you, I don't know that you would really be interested in forensics.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's tough because sometimes you might have that kid that comes to you that says, I'd like to know what forensics is, but I don't know if I'm good at any of that kind of stuff. And you might say, I'm not sure either. You can come check it out and come watch. And if they don't do that, you might have one of those gyms that could just be the one that you know, can do it all, might get away. And so that's one thing that I try to do too, is say, come take a look, come watch and see what we do. At the home meet, that's a good one for kids to go to. There's also times when I've taken kids on the bus to go up and watch a meet somewhere else. And they can go watch three different rounds of three different events and see if one of those strikes their fancy. And that's really the best way to explain it. And really, even whenever I get kids into forensics and get them involved in a certain area, whether it's interp or debate or speech, it really doesn't take hold in their mind until they do it. And that's what I call a pulling off the band-aid effect, is they'll prepare a speech or they'll prepare an interp piece and say, okay, I think I'm ready to go. Oh, but I don't know. I might be coming down with something. I might be getting sick. Because it's stepping into this void of the unknown. They don't know what to expect. And so sometimes I just have to say, go. You've got to go. I signed you up already. I've already paid for you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's too bad that you feel like you might have a tickle in your throat. You've got to go anyway. And most of them will go begrudgingly. Mm-hmm. And then they'll get there and they'll do a couple of rounds and say, okay. And then they usually come out and talk to me. And they're like this. Oh my gosh, I saw this piece that was, and this thing that he was doing, I couldn't believe it. And they get into a debate and they just come out and they're just wired.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun to see, but really, you can explain it until they're bleeding out of their ears, but until they do it, they don't really understand it. And so that's tough to really get them to understand it without doing it, because, you know, as I'm trying to recruit kids, how do I do that? You know, and so
sure.
That's one of the things that I use the home meet for, is to get those kids to come and see. And so I think a lot of what it takes is, the first part is the want to. Kids that come into it and say, I'm going to do this kind of part-time. Mm-hmm. And even some of those become the best ones because they get hooked and then they continue to do it and they flourish. What it really takes is repetition. They need a chance to do it often, over and over again. And whenever you get the ones that are really going to excel, those are the ones who will practice at the school, and then they'll go home and they'll rehearse. They'll meet up with their duo partner and go over their blocking. And Jacob and Jeremy are notorious for, you know, meeting with me and practicing and then going home on a Friday night and then coming Saturday morning and saying, we changed everything. What do you mean you changed everything?
Yeah.
How'd you change everything? We went through this and this and this and this, and we came up with some great stuff. Yeah, but it's even better now. We changed it all. And I say, okay. You know, because really, the ones who are performing it, after they get that feedback, they can see, oh, this wasn't working, and he suggested we do this, but what if we did this instead? And that would really work to fill that same void that he was seeing before, and usually it comes back and it's even better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so it's that repetition of it, and then that ability to follow through with it and to see the things, I guess, that don't necessarily need to be pointed out by a coach or a judge, to be able to sense it in your own performance. And the ones that I've had that have had really good success have been able to do that.